This week on the Water Bottle Diary, we're going to talk about one of my favorite art forms, dance. And who better to talk to than to Terence Lewis, who has mastered the craft and continues to inspire young dancers through his reality shows as a judge, through his dance company and classes. Terence is joining us today from his car. So it's an unusual interview for us too. Terence, thank you for joining us on the Water Bottle Diary. You're in a car and you're already working and shooting. So I think to begin with, tell me what this pandemic has been like. Have you been working? Have you been creating more stuff, or has it been stressful and not too much work to do?
It began with a little bit of concern and, you know, trepidation on the fact that, you know, how are we going to kind of, you know, figure our businesses out and all that jazz. And, you know, I was shooting for my show, so that had got stalled. And then, you know, after the initial shock had settled in a month's time, I kind of accepted the reality and then, you know, had to work on my own company because, you know, we had to move our teaching courses on ground to online. So it took me all my energies, you know, to kind of put everything on track, you know, the logistics and figure everything out in detail, plan it out. So all that happened. Now that happened. And then after that, immediately in August, we were given the, you know, the go ahead from the chief minister saying that, you know, we can start shooting. So we were the first ones to start shooting. So I've been shooting since August and now we're in November. We're almost reaching the finale. Life has come back to normal really, but just with the same protocols, like, you know, wear your mask and keep distance and, you know, get yourself tested from time to time. These are the protocols that are being followed at the shoot space. So yeah, so, you know, and yeah, I mean, I take care of my immunity. I kind of eat well, I exercise. So in a way I take some sun, you know, as much as I can, and basically taking care of yourself and, you know, watching out for any kind of symptoms. So yeah, just that's about it. And life is normal. It's a new normal now.
But what has it been like to do your classes online? Is it very different? Did it take a lot of getting used to?
Not at all. It's just that it is different in the sense that, you know, you lack the human connection. And, you know, when people come together in a room, there's a shared energy. Right now, you are insulated behind a camera. So you, all you got to do is just, you know, build up all the energy so that, you know, you can, you know, you can make sure that this, the way you're teaching is interesting and, you know, it has a certain kind of a level, that kind of an energy that kind of, you know, keeps the students, you know, happy and engaged. You know, so the challenge for my team of instructors who are teaching is just the fact to keep the energy levels up, because otherwise it was a shared responsibility, you know. The students also give you a certain amount of energy when they are inside the space. Here, because they are behind their screens and you're behind your screen, you kind of, you know, lose that connection and that vibe. But, you know, we have been trained now to mentally, you know, block that out and just, you know, work with these, you know, with these new modalities. And then, you know, just make sure that, you know, the class is fun, interesting, that there's enough connection, human connection, that you're asking enough questions. We're much slower in our teaching, so, you know, people get really, don't get nervous, or they don't feel that, okay, we're getting alienated. So those are all things that we kept in mind, you know, giving personal corrections as and when. So all of that is happening.
Right. And I'm going to go back a little bit in rewind mode because for a lot of people who love dance, so I want to go back to the beginning and ask you when you started. At what age did you start dancing?
I really didn't, you know, fancy dancing as such. It's just that, you know, it's not that I looked at something and I said, I want to be a dancer. It was just a teacher who said, randomly came to class when I was six, who wants to participate in the dance competition, inter-school dance competition, inter-class dance competition. And nobody put their hands up. And I'm a person who loves to be different. So I put my hand up. And then before I knew it, I had to kind of, you know, prepare something in dance. And I just took some song, which was a Boney M, and I danced on Brown Girl in the Ring. And I won the first prize. And, you know, it was more of a, taking a chance on dance, really. And that's how life has been for me. I've always taken chances. I've always been more adventurous in that sense. And that has led me to certain, you know, understanding of myself. So it's the adventure inside me and the thrill that I seek in that adventure that drives me, that kind of, you know, decides many of the things that, you know, I end up, you know, with. So it was more of a, you know, of a chance meeting with dance. And it, you know, started to kind of, you know, I started getting noticed, then I started taking part in singing and music and theater. And, you know, dancing was not such a big thing that time. So it was more of theater, more of singing, and a lot of sports because my brother was in sports. So I was more into sports. My training never began. I never trained as a dancer. But fortunately, for 3 months when I was was 13 years old, I got a little shot in the arm by a judge who had come to judge me in a dance competition, gave me the first prize, and she said, "Okay, you come for my dance classes. You need to train because you're good, but you're not that good. You need to train." And I just got 3 months, like 3 months, hardly like, what can you say, maybe like 20 sessions. It was 20 sessions of, 3 months training. But it was enough for me because I used to stay back after my classes, watch her teach others' classes also. And I learned a lot just by observing. Her name was Parvez Shetty. She was from the States and she had come down and she had learned, jazz ballet. So it kind of really, that was my first understanding of, formal, what dancing would look like. But I was still not trained in that sense. But I kind of, I'm a very quick learner. So if I can see something, I can immediately understand how it functions. Like I am able to break it down very easily in my head. So I did that for myself and it worked out pretty well. And then later on when I was 17, I got a chance to kind of, teach dance, even though I had not learned dance. And I kind of knew organically how to do it because I was already teaching math, science, English tuition. So I just had to break down dance like the way I was breaking down math, science, English,
Right. Yeah.
And I broke it down and I understood the empathy that you need to teach when you're dance teaching people who don't have to dance. I think that kind of, led me to realize, I have a good teaching skill and a good command over the language. More importantly, as I taught, I also learned myself, because when you have to teach, you have to fully understand what you are teaching. And that gives you a better grip of the subject. So in a way, it helped me to understand dance a little better by just analyzing it by myself, because I had to teach it now. So it was great. And then much later, at 26, I actually got, a chance to go to New York and study. I collected money. I made some money. And then I went and I realized that I was just making money, but not really growing as a dancer. And then I decided that there was nothing in my country that could help me. That time, there was nothing, absolutely nothing, in terms of professional training programs. So then I went to Alvin Ailey School in New York. I did the summer intensive there. Then it was, a spate of other things. I did Broadway Dance Center there also. Then I came back in a few years. Again, I got a scholarship for contemporary dance and that changed my life.
So did you choose to do contemporary right at the beginning?
No, I didn't do contemporary. I was more into modern and jazz. Okay. And then suddenly I had to kind of start dancing and creating stuff for my own stage shows. I used to move in a certain way, which I thought was my style. And then much later, once that I did a performance in which there was a German choreographer called Susanna Linke, and she noticed and she said, "Listen, you have a thing for contemporary dance and, you need to train because you're rough around the edges, And I was like, wow, okay, what is that? And then I discovered that there is a whole form called contemporary dance. What was coming to me organically, but very roughly, not really mastered it, but just coming very organically, was contemporary dance. And when I was trying to dance myself, and that helped, then she gave me a scholarship to, Austria, Vienna. She helped me get the scholarship where I have been teaching now for the last 15 years. That changed my life. The Impulse Dance Festival called scholarship.
Now, when did you start doing film first in India? Was it Lagan? Was that the first?
Yeah, 1999, 2000 was Lagan.
And how did that come about? Is it very different from choreographing something on stage and choreographing it for the camera?
It is. So it's basically very different because the full body is seen on stage, so you can't cheat. On camera, definitely cheat. Also, camera, you have to kind of make it very personal because the audience, has to get a very personal feel. So you can't keep shooting wides. You have to get into the face of the character. You have to get into small, details of the arms and hands to kind of accentuate. You can make something look really great, even if it's not through film. That's one aspect. And secondly, the stage is requires you to be really disciplined as a dancer. It has its plus and minuses. And choreographing for films, you require a certain understanding of the camera, the lensing, blocking, understanding, that you cannot shoot sequentially. You have to shoot it in non-sequentially, which means you can't go linear, which means you might probably have shot planned in one area of the probably of the location, and there are five areas of the location you need, and that part which you want to shoot, or maybe as on the edit you want one portion in the end to be shot in the first location, then you can't shoot sequentially. You have to shoot all those portions first, which are in one location, because once you shift, the light man will not relight the whole place again for you. So you need to have a certain amount of, you know, I mean, you learn as you go. So it's a different ball game altogether.
Is it easier now? You judge a lot of reality shows, and the number of dancers you encounter, and like you just said, you know, there was hardly anything when you started dancing. There's so much more. There's so many more platforms right now. So is it easier in any way for dancers today to take it up as a commercially viable career?
Totally, because now the avenues have opened. There are more opportunities. Of course, I'm talking about pre-COVID, not post-COVID. Okay. Post-COVID will be a different reality. But pre-COVID, it was booming, and it has boomed, and it has done very well after the advent of television reality shows.
So how does it, what happens to, like, you know, people who participate win? What do they go on to do? Do they get more shows? How does it work?
I mean, they need to kind of realize that, you know, they were not known at all, and suddenly their price points for taking a workshop or a class goes into lakhs. So obviously right. They're making more money than when they started off, and they were getting only hundreds. So where is getting paid 500 to 1,000 bucks for a class going to, you know, a few lakhs? It's a huge difference. It's a huge jump. The only thing is that you have to, you know, the high that you get from in a show, to maintain that is difficult. So, you know, you get padded up so well, and, you know, you are pushed and cushioned so well in the show, and then you are taken to a certain level. To maintain that, that energy and that fame is not easy, and sometimes you can psychologically damage you. That's if you're stupid, and if you are immature, and if it has come too easy, and if you're not grounded, and if you do not know how to handle success, then it's a problem. Because success will come and it will go away very fast. So you need to kind of, you know, while it is still there, know how to kind of, you know, multiply and make more out of it. The television show is only interested for that season, because they have to make the next season and the next show, and they'll build up the next superstar. And by the time the next superstar comes, you'll be forgotten. So in that interim bit, it's very important to kind of, you know, modify yourself, to kind of make sure you do a lot of workshops. You have to have a plan. I mean, the television show is just a platform. It's not there to say that, boss, we're going to take care of you for life. You're not an employee of theirs.
Right.
You know, but they're giving you this platform. They're making you so big. They're making you reach out what would never, you can't dream of. And it's giving you judges who will kind of, you know, praise you and, you know, make you look great, and you're getting third party validation. Now, all of that, you got to take and make a show reel and cut, and, you know, you got to promote yourself, find event managers, go, you know, there's paid work. There's a lot to do there. Now, you need to find that. You need to be a smart person to do that. That's all.
So we see so many of these contestants have a backstory where they're either trying to prove a point to their parents or to people who don't think this is an option. Did you have it easy? Did your family, were they always okay with dance?
They weren't, but they didn't have a choice, because I'm very stubborn and I'm very independent. And because post 15, my father said, do what you want, because my job is done. I educated you till your 10th standard, and then what you want to do is your life. And they were a little upset, you know, simply because I was the most brightest kid of the all eight children. I was scholastically inclined. I was a straight A student, you know, always doing very well in my studies. And I wanted to become a doctor. Then I went to do biochemistry in my BSc. Then I went to do hotel management. Again, you know, was a topper there. So they were like, you know, all of this, and then, you know, you are going to go for dancing and blah blah blah. So, but they were like, you know, they can't, like, I'm very focused and clear and determined. When I want something, I just, there's no way you can change my mind. So I'm very clear in my decision making processes, you know. So, and I don't entertain anybody, you know, that time. Like, you know, I'm not interested. It's my life. I'm not, you know, asking you to take care of me. So it's very simple. It's straight out there. And yes, it was difficult. Yes, it was a lot of pressure. Yes, it was a proving point. But my parents were like, you know, yeah, whatever you have to kind of, it's your decision. Now you, whatever happens is yours. If it's good, if you became successful, it would be only because of you, not because of us. And if you didn't, it would also be because of you. So it's perfectly fine. It was a fair game. And that was same for all my siblings also. It's just that they took more conventional careers. I took an unconventional one.
But do you enjoy this the most? Do you enjoy creating new work for the company? Do you enjoy judging the most? Or do you enjoy films and choreographing for movies?
I like variety. So I can't stay in one thing for the same time. I'm not somebody who can get stuck and get fixated with one thing. I need to change. I need to evolve. I need constant, variety in my work and in my people also. So I love to judge. I love to teach. I love to create. I love to perform. And I love to do many other things. So I need to keep evolving. I need to keep doing things differently because I get bored very easily. I have a boredom issue. And I get bored after I reach a certain level of, achieve. Then I'm like, okay, I've achieved this. Now I don't want to do the same thing in repeat mode. So I need change. So if there's change, it's good. I don't mind being a student all over again, learning something different. As long as there's some growth. I need growth in my life.
You'd also done this Beauty and the Beast as a theater, musical theater here, right? How did that go? Is there a reason why we don't do it very often in India?
Well, the ticket price points are very high, firstly.
Okay.
Disney's Beauty and the Beast was a very premium kind of a show. It was the original Disney's Beauty and the Beast. And it had a certain kind of a standard protocol about costumes, hair, makeup, voices, artists, dancers. Every dancer's size, shape, face had to be checked by Disney before. It was a very strict protocol, and it was a very good protocol. They were very sensible. They were very humane in many ways. They were very good with equal treatment. So it was a very fancy, and I have to give it to Siddharth Roy Kapoor because he ensured that everybody was treated well. Everybody got paid correctly. It was one of the most fancy productions, and the quality of work was excellent. I don't think anybody can match the quality of work that Beauty and the Beast put out there. So the experience was great, but it's very hard to sustain and maintain because we don't have a culture for going and watching theater. So we are more of a sedentary person. We don't have a culture to enjoy theater. So that's why less demand, therefore less shows.
I don't know if you remember, but the first time I saw you rather was, I was going to say met, and then I realized it was so, was at Xavier's. There was this, it was Malhar as always. And you were judging one of these, somebody had just performed and, they were asking for comments, and you said you saw their performance and said, Martha Graham will turn in her grave if you call this contemporary. Have you? And I remember that stayed with me for so long, and I was like, poor guys, they must have after their performance. But have you mellowed down as a judge now that you do it so often?
The truth needs to be said. It needs to be said very kindly. That's the only difference. But the truth needs to be said. I don't think we should shy away from the truth. But how you say it, if you use the filter of love, then it's lovely. But sometimes if you praise somebody falsely, I feel that is more hurtful. Sometimes kindness can be cruel. You'd rather be, truthful, but say it with love. And when you say it with love and when you say it with caringness, I think it changes everything. You shouldn't stop being genuine and honest. But you shouldn't stop being kind either.
Right. Okay, last question. I wanted to know, so you've said that you didn't initially train. And now all these kids who come to the shows on TV, they are getting a lot of mentorship and training. Is it really important for all the young people watching? Is it important to get formal training according to you?
Totally, because the level of dancing is so high and the kind of expectation and demand on the body is so much that if you ever join a dance competition show where you're back to back every week perform, the kind of load that your body goes through, if your body is not strong, well-prepared, trained and understands how the movement works, you will be injured in the first week. Because the kind of things we need to do, the kind of expectations, the benchmark is very high. So getting trained, understanding the body, understanding how the mechanics of, movement work, the physiology, the anatomy is super important. because that alignment, that geometry of understanding what will stabilize you, what muscles to be relaxed, what muscles to be used, all of that is a very important aspect if you want to kind of dance, because dance is a very physical activity. Yeah. You can get injured very easily. You can get tired very easily. So if you're not practiced, and if you don't have a certain rhythm, and if you don't have a discipline, you will not be able to be a dancer. That's why Martha Graham said it very beautifully. You do not choose dance. Dance chooses you. And with that, you live. So those who have to dance, and there's one more thing that she said very beautifully. When a dancer had come to her and says, you know, should I dance? And she said, if you have to ask, the answer is no.
Yeah.
Which basically means that, you know, people who have to who are dancers, they don't question why they are dancing. They just know that they cannot not dance. So they have been chosen, and that's why they will do whatever it takes. You know, whatever pain, whatever suffering it takes to kind of be a dancer. It's a very, you have to suffer a lot to be a dancer. You have to put yourself through a lot in terms of your eating habits, in terms of your discipline, in terms of your energy, you're constantly being compared to somebody. There's so much competition. It's very competitive, you know? So there's so much of insecurity on a mental level. You have to constantly push your body. So it's not an easy life. It's not an easy life. Therefore, you don't choose dance. Dance chooses you.
Thank you so much for taking the time in this busy room and talking to us. Thank you.
No problem. Take care, Supita. Bye-bye.
I hope this interview inspires you to put on your dancing shoes. If you like the video, please subscribe to our YouTube channel, hit like on the video and share it. Keep coming back to us on the Water Bottle Diary for more stories with a soul.